It's time to take your business to the next level, the boss level. These are the premier business owner strategies and successes being utilized by the industry's top talent today. Rock your business like a boss, a VO boss. Now let's welcome your host, Anne Ganguza.
Hey everyone, welcome to the VO Boss Podcast. I'm your host, Anne Ganguza, and today I'm honored to bring back special guest co-host Pilar Uribe. Pilar is a bilingual voice actor, telenovela star, and radio personality. Born and raised in New York City, she broke into show business and had roles with Ugly Betty, Poor Pablo, Eternally Manuela, and El Cartel, filmed in Colombia and Miami. And in our last episode, we talked about her story, and we ended up from Colombia, now she's arrived in Miami. So we're going to continue the story today. And before that, I want to say that she also has a booth kitty. And outside of my booth right now, Pilar, is my cute little Sabrina cat who is jealous because the door is closed and I know she wants to come in. So she wants to come in and talk to you as well.
I love it.
Pilar, it's so great to have you back.
I'm so glad to be here. Thank you, Anne.
And what an amazing story. Like I said, triple, quadruple threat, TV, radio, voiceover, singer. I mean, you have done it all. And what an interesting, wonderful story you had telling us last episode about your theater experience, your television experience, and your success story in Colombia. And you decided to come back to the States and decided to move to Miami. So
yes.
Let's pick up from your arrival in Miami and your career once you got there.
So I get to Miami and I am staying with my cousins who live in Key Biscayne. I'm thinking, I'm all that, you know, I'm this telenovela star. Where do I sign?
Mm-hmm.
Luckily, I got an agent really quickly because a friend of mine introduced me to this friend who was a casting director, and the casting director met with me and said, hey, you know, there's this agent. And so I get this agent really quickly, and she starts sending me out.
And so, this is an agent, not a voiceover agent, but you had just started
when you were
the tail end, I think, when you were at Columbia, you said you started doing some voiceover for an animated series. So this agent is on camera?
Yeah, my whole, up until now, my whole concentration was acting.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't voice acting because that's how I had made my bread and butter for the previous
mm-hmm.
9 years.
Sure.
And so the voice acting that I did in Colombia and, you know, the fascination I had with radio was just kind of like a fun thing. You know, it was just kind of like a fun thing, but I didn't
mm-hmm.
look at it as anything serious.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I get this on-camera agent and I start auditioning and she sends me out an audition and auditions and auditions and I get nothing. And I'm like, oh, dear. Okay.
Now, interesting, you talked before about how you had set visions, right, and
yep.
meditated. Did
yep.
you go back to that once
no.
you were in Miami?
No.
Mm. Interesting.
I did not. Not at the beginning,
mm-hmm.
okay? The one thing that has probably been a constant my entire life is the importance of training.
Mm-hmm.
So even while I was on television every night, I was taking acting classes.
Mm.
And I did them periodically. And I worked with some great people in Colombia. And so then I realized, ooh, I'm not booking. I had better get on the horn and I had better start going back. And so I started taking auditioning classes
mm-hmm.
because I had really stopped auditioning. You know, I would audition for a role and I would get it. You know, it was just kind of like
sure.
that kind of thing.
I was going to ask you if you know, what were differences, right, when you were in Colombia versus Florida? What differences in the auditioning process or differences in, I don't know, anything in terms of getting roles? What was different that you noticed?
Well, for one thing, the community was much larger. So there was a lot more competition.
Got it.
Which means that people were way more polished in their auditions.
Mm.
It was very, very much more competitive. So I realized because I was out of practice, auditioning was not something that I was doing on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
When I was living in New York, I did that on a regular basis. And, you know, one of the things that I learned in Miami from a very close friend of mine, he said, auditioning is the job acting is what you get to do once in a while.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Auditioning is the job. Acting is the hobby.
Yeah. Similar to voice acting, right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So I started doing that, and I started getting better at auditioning.
Mm-hmm.
And I started actually booking theater roles. So I became pretty regular in booking theater gigs,
mm-hmm.
which I loved because I got to, you know, I got to go back to, you know, when I used to do it a lot more after college and stuff. But still, you know, that didn't really pay the bills.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that I would notice was that the theater actors, they would talk about how they were going to the studios, the dubbing studios, or they were coming to or they were going from. And I was like, kind of curious, you know, what's this whole dubbing thing about?
Mm-hmm.
And so a friend of mine said, well, you know, why don't you go to this studio? And so I called somebody up, and it was a friend of a friend. And so I went and I auditioned. And that's the very first time I saw like a studio with different booths.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, oh, this is really interesting. And so I was dubbing from another language, and they were all in Spanish. They were doing all these dubbing, these telenovelas from Spanish into English. And so...
Did you have any training in it previously, or was it just something that you kind of picked up?
Zero, yet mm-hmm. again. Mm-hmm. Just like when I went down to Colombia, I had very little training in TV, and then I had no training in doing this.
But then you had all experience in television, in being
yes.
in television, so that I'm sure helped you in your dubbing experience, because you already knew what it was like to be the actor, right, on camera. And
right.
now you could absolutely probably just parallel that with dubbing.
Exactly. So the mm-hmm. acting part of it was
yeah.
the important part.
Yep,
but there's
exactly.
the technical side of it,
mm-hmm.
which is you have to match lips.
Mm-hmm.
And as they say out here, lip flaps. So you have mm-hmm. to figure that part out. So I auditioned a lot, didn't get very far, and I continued. I continued to do my theater, and I did a little bit of commercials.
Mm-hmm. Now, at this time, was it all in Spanish, or was it both?
No, it was all dubbing from Spanish into English.
Okay.
Yeah, it was 100%.
Mm-hmm.
Or from, but I was just auditioning, you know. So
mm-hmm.
I auditioned quite a few times, and then I actually got a gig.
Meaning, I guess my question would be, like, were you auditioning for roles in Spanish or both Spanish and English at the time, auditioning?
So here's the thing. My experience up until this moment was mm-hmm. only with dubbing.
Okay.
I had no other access to like what is now, you know, doing commercial voiceover or mm-hmm. medical narration or e-learning. I didn't know any part of that business.
I'm thinking even on camera. When you were
oh.
auditioning on camera, were you auditioning for roles that were Spanish or for
yes.
Spanish and English, both?
Both.
Okay.
I was doing
okay.
both. I was, yeah. So my life has always been about doing both. Yeah.
Yeah. The reason why I wanted to call that out is because for a person, I am not bilingual, right? For me, there's only just English. So I want to make sure that I hear when you are talking bilingual, like you have like almost, is it more opportunity or is it more work for more opportunity? And what are the things that you need to be considerate of when you are auditioning for both Spanish and English, or are there differences? So it's just something for me, it's a new perspective.
So I think that the most important thing, really, it all comes down to the acting, Anne.
Mm.
It's not really
right.
about the language, because it all starts from inside.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, with the on-camera, and this is what I discovered when I was doing dubbing, is that whatever you're looking at, what's in front of you on
mm-hmm.
the screen,
mm-hmm.
if you're dubbing a woman who is, or a character who is in pain, or who is crying,
mm-hmm.
you have to feel that pain.
Mm-hmm.
You have to feel that sadness, because if you don't, it's not going to show up in your voice.
Sure, sure, exactly.
It's not about manipulating
mm-hmm.
the voice. It's about
mm-hmm.
starting from the inside out,
mm-hmm.
which is what a lot of people, when they're first starting out in the business, I hear this all the time
oh, yeah.
everywhere on Clubhouse. Oh, I've got a really good voice, and how do I make my voice
mm-hmm.
this? And it's like,
yeah.
no, that's
yeah.
not what it's about. It has to start, that's why the acting
matters.
From the
matters. Inside. Mm-hmm.
It
yeah.
has to start from the inside.
Yeah, I got off a little bit on a
no,
tangent
no, no,
there,
no,
but
no,
yeah.
No.
So yeah, continuing while you are auditioning like crazy in Florida.
So I'm auditioning like crazy for voiceover, but I'm still doing my theater, I'm doing my commercials.
Mm-hmm.
I gave myself, for the first time in my life, I went on this cruise it was called, what was it called? Celebrate Your Life, Louise Hay Cruz.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very spiritual. And there were all these great speakers. Wayne Dyer was there.
Yep, yep.
Greg Braden was there. It was like the coolest thing. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I met somebody. It was like, ooh, this is really cool. And then I came back and I get this call for an audition. And they're, this friend of mine who's an actor, he's like, well, you know, they want you to audition in this dubbing studio for this role. And I get the role.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time that I get the role, I have this major health challenge. And I'm like, oh no, what's going to happen? And I'm like, you know what? I'm going to do this. I'm just going to do this. And then the enormity of it hits me because I'm like, oh, wait a minute. I don't know anything about voiceover. I don't know how to do this. It's like, I'm an actor. And so I was really lucky because I had this great engineer, Rafael. I'll never forget him. And he kind of guided me. And we would do it like on a weekly basis because I was dubbing a show. I was dubbing a series and it was, coincidentally, it was Colombian.
Mm-hmm.
So I just started dubbing an episode or two a week and he would teach me. And he'd be like, okay, I need a little bit more from you. Do this from you. A lot of it was just observing and listening and looking what was on the screen and doing what that character was doing on the screen and incorporating it into myself in English through my voice. So, you know, I did that. I got better. Then I got a call from another studio and then a third studio. And I was like, oh, this is really cool. Success begets success.
Right?
Exactly. Now, here's the thing about Miami. Miami's a right-to-work state. So the rates are not that great. Dubbing in itself is not a moneymaker.
I was going to say that. And especially now, given the current situation, I know Netflix has just gone crazy and there's lots of opportunities for dubbing these days.
Yes. But here's the thing. The good thing about the union, they signed an agreement, I think it was 2 years ago with Netflix. So they have to have certain rates.
Good. That's excellent.
Yeah.
Well, I was just meaning I'm hearing so much about more opportunities these days since the pandemic, since there's just a lot of, Netflix has been producing a lot more movies.
Yes.
And the streaming
yes.
stations. So I feel like there's more dubbing opportunities that I'm hearing about these days.
Yes, yeah. A ton. It's really
yeah.
great.
Yeah.
So I start doing more and then I realize, oh, well, this is interesting, but again, not much money. So I thought, well, let me try. Somebody told me about an audiobook kind of a situation. I thought, oh, okay, this is interesting. Let me see what's going on with that. And so I get on ACX. I do my first book. The book is terrible. Okay, I'm gonna tell you right now.
This is why I don't do books. I'm just saying.
Oh my God, the book.
I did one.
The book itself wasn't terrible.
Mm-hmm.
My recording. I mean, I don't think, you know, people have bought the book and I've done, you know, a bunch of books since then, but I look back at that first book and I was like, oh my gosh, it's really kind of frightening. But, you know, I really got into it because it was a character driven.
Sure.
Again, though, if you're not a technical person, everybody talks about getting into audiobooks. The one thing I will say, and it's gotten a lot better, the technology's gotten a lot better, but if you're not a super duper whiz at editing.
Oh, it's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work, is all I'm going to say.
Any long format narration, but especially books. Yes.
Especially books.
So much work.
It's a lot. It's a lot. So
and the money that you're making from it, it was like, gosh, it's so much work for not a lot of money. So,
I totally agree.
Yeah.
I totally agree.
Mm-hmm.
So I did a couple. I didn't do that many. Mm-hmm. I did a couple. And then I was like, oh, this is just so much work. I started off, I had a booth in my kitchen, outside of my kitchen. It was in the living room. And a friend of mine helped me, you know, construct it. It was really great. And then I discovered that every 10 minutes I had to stop because the stupid sound of the refrigerator would come into the recording.
Yes.
Oh my gosh. You have no idea how terrible that was. So I moved it into a closet, which I actually had a really good, very, very narrow, but long closet. So I, after a couple of iterations, that became my studio, but I still wasn't making a lot of money. So I decided, you know what, I'm going to send out feelers for like a 9-to-5 job or a part-time job
in
radio.
Well, I was just going to ask you that because there's so many people when they're trying to get into voiceover and they want to go full-time. And even when I started full-time, I had to have a part-time job so that I felt like I could contribute to paying the bills in terms of the household for sure. So I was wondering through all those years when you were like kind of scraping by, did you have a second job doing something different, like, I don't know, waitress, bartender, corporate?
I always had an administrative job going. Like, I was an administrative assistant a friend of mine. And she was great because I could always go and come back.
Yeah.
She was really understanding.
So you could do your auditions.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So, you know, sometimes I would work for her full time. Sometimes I would work part time. Mm-hmm. So it was really great to be able to go back and forth in that. But yeah, I always had a second job. Mm-hmm. And then I realized, you know, what if I could have a second job doing something like radio? So I went down the list of all the radio stations in Miami. Again, and now I'm realizing it as we're having this conversation, I marketed myself out to them.
There you go. Did you manifest? Did you manifest your
I started manifesting. Yes, I went back to that. Yes, ma'am. I started seeing myself in front of a microphone. Absolutely. And I didn't get one bite, okay? Indeed.com, I papered my resume, and I spent a year and a half looking for this. But I set an intention. I said, I'm going to get a radio job. And the very last place that I looked at was, and I was talking to my friend, who I'd been her administrative assistant. We became each other's accountability buddies. She said, well, why don't you call up WLRN? WLRN is the NPR satellite in Miami. And I had looked at their website, and it said that there was a 3 to 5 year position. And I was like, yeah, 3 to 5 years experience needed. And I thought, no, I don't have 3 to 5 years. And she said, just write them. Just say you're willing to work for them. You know, just say, you know. And I was like, you know what? Why not?
I'm eager to learn.
Exactly. That's what exactly. I'm eager to learn. I had sent out so many resumes, Anne, and to so many different, all of the companies in Miami. So I'm talking to her, and this is the great part. This is like the manifesting part, because I really, really was manifesting this heavily. I send it out while I'm talking to my friend on the phone. I knew how to do this by heart by now. I'd composed a letter. I sent my resume. I sent a couple of samples. Not 20 minutes later, I get a call from the guy.
Wow.
Saying, do you want to meet? And I was like, sure. I'd love to. So I went and I met with them a couple of times, and they started me off working for them. So this was a part-time job because they were affiliated with a school. And so they said, well, you know, we'll get you on the air and then you'll do some spots for us. I was like, okay, great. So before a month was out, I was on the air and I was doing spots for them, underwriting spots. They don't call them commercials because it's, you know, it's non-for-profit.
So it wasn't a show. You just started doing spots for them.
I started doing spots for them, but then they put me on the air from 10 to 2.
Okay.
And then, so what I would do was that on my breaks, because I was hired from, you know, I would get there like, let's say 9:30, and then I would leave after my spot. So between breaks, when the shows were on, I would go into the other room and do the spots. Then they started giving more spots, and then they started giving me more spots. And then I managed to eke out a deal with them through the union, and so that I would do their, and I would produce their spots. So I would put music and sound effects under for their TV arm of the company.
Wait, so remember when I said quadruple threat? So now we've got yet another. Now she's producing.
Well, but again,
as well.
Anne, I have no idea what I'm doing.
Yep.
Right? Because I, you know, I would just play record.
Sure.
So now I have to now I have to do tracks, and I had to learn a whole set of other skills
because
I didn't know how to do a console, how to handle a console and do three things at once. So now I'm producing spots, and then they give me more, and then they give me more, and I'm like, wow, okay, I'm getting, it's almost like the 10,000 hours, and you know, in Outliers. Yeah. It's like I'm getting all this training.
I think that's great, and I love the 10,000 hours thing from Malcolm, and I am a total proponent of you need 10,000 hours, and whether you realize it or not, you had put your 10,000 hours in many aspects of your career, and again, if I can recap, you manifested you wanted to be in radio. It didn't happen overnight, and that's one thing I want to kind of just touch back upon, because a lot of times I think we're impatient with ourselves, and I think for me, going by my gut, this is what I always say, going by my gut, manifestation doesn't always happen overnight, and I think that it leads you to the right steps to get to the right place so that you can fulfill that dream or that goal. And so even though it didn't happen overnight, it did happen because you manifested it. You wanted it. You took the steps that were required to make it happen, and it happened. So bosses out there, if you're listening, we can all be learning about this. We can all give ourselves some grace, be patient, but believe in the manifestation and take those steps that it takes to cultivate and achieve that dream. So sorry, just had to break in there with the educational moment.
And it's so important what you just said, Anne, mm-hmm. because we're thinking that when we call it into being, let's say we're manifesting mm-hmm. it, mm-hmm. that it's going to happen on our timeline.
Exactly.
Well, who died and made you God?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Who said that you would be doing this, or in my case, that because I said I want to work in radio, that next month, the following month, I was going to be working in radio? No.
Right.
No, that's not the way it happens. It's like there are steps.
Mm-hmm.
And if you cut those steps and you jump, you're going to be disappointed or you're going to do it the wrong way. There's a mm-hmm. reason that the things come into your life when they come into your life.
Oh, yeah.
And it's mm-hmm. because it's when you're ready to receive them,
mm-hmm.
then you can go, oh, because at that moment when I sent out that resume, I was ready. I might not have been ready if I had sent it out earlier. It mm-hmm. may not have hit in the right way.
Sure.
Later, I talked to my boss at WLRN and he said, you know, I get resumes all the time.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that when I read yours, it really fit because you're a Latina, so mm-hmm. you could say all these complicated words that would come out in Spanish and French because I also speak French. So, you know, sometimes these things would...
And yet another threat. No. I love it.
But, you know, like sometimes there would be these weird companies, they're just French companies. So with
sure.
the accent,
sure.
it would just come out better.
Mm-hmm.
And I will say one thing that was really fun when I was working in radio was that I got to say my name the way I would say it. Because like if I mm-hmm. say my name, like, you know, my name is Pilar Uribe, and that's mm-hmm. how I slate, Pilar Uribe. But once in a while, I get to slate my name the way I would say it on the radio, which was,
sure.
mi nombre es Pilar Uribe. Hola,
oh.
Pilar Uribe. So it's like, it's so much fun to mm-hmm. actually say my name because I don't get to do that very often.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
So it was fun to be able to use the bilingual aspect of it. I was literally daily using it in the mm-hmm. studio because I had to pronounce words in a certain way.
Sure.
You know, so that was really fun to do.
So now how long was your radio career with WLRN?
It was 2.5 years.
Okay.
And one day, my landlady writes me an email and says, I'm selling the apartment. I'd spent my 16 years in Miami in the same apartment. I had a great landlady.
Mm-hmm.
Always had really good luck with that. And I panicked. I was like, oh my gosh, what do I do? And I thought, this is the moment. This is the time. I had
For
been
change.
Talking about moving. Yeah. And this is the moment to go and move. And this is the moment for a shift.
Mm-hmm.
I literally felt the shift. I was terrified. And I will say that one of the things about doing something new is that there's always the element of fear. Always.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
So to sit there and, you know, when people say, oh, yeah, I went and I had to did this. And, you know, you hear these marketing gurus. I listen to them on Clubhouse. And, you know, they do this. And I got this and I did this. And it's like all of that happens with fear. It's just that the courage to be able to change.
To move through it.
Is mm-hmm. And to move through it
mm-hmm.
is.
To work
is,
through it.
Is higher.
Doesn't mean that you're not scared.
Exactly.
You're moving through it. And you know what's so interesting about the move? I've got two stories about moving and change. I remember when I felt like I needed the change. And one was when, you know, my husband and I were in New Jersey and I said, I'm done. I love New Jersey. It's served me well, but I'm done. And I would love to go live in California. Jerry, why don't you see if you can get a transfer? And lo and behold, he did. And then I said to him, oh, by the way, Jerry, I need you to be able to make 1.5 times what you're making now because I want to quit my job and go full-time into VO. And guess what? It happened. However, 9 months after that, he then got laid off from his job. But we stayed. We stayed, you know, we moved to California. We stayed in California. And we worked through it. Everybody said, when are you coming back? I'm like, I'm not coming back. So I worked through the first few years of being full-time voiceover. And it was just one of those things. I had my goals in mind and just set my brain to it. And somehow I've arrived here, thankfully, gratefully. But the second time I said, I need a change, we had been in Irvine for 12 years. And I said, I'm done. thank you, Irvine. It's been wonderful. We need to move, Jerry. And it was one of those things where I didn't even, he was on a business trip and I said, Jerry, I need to go somewhere else. I know I've got a good 10 years left before, 10, 15 years before if I retire at all. And I need to do it in a new place. And so basically I just said, I want to move. But putting that move into place, we literally got in like maybe a week before lockdown to our new house. So we had to sell the house. I had to stage the house. We bought a new house. The new house wasn't ready. We had to move someplace in the interim with the cats, with, you know, sell the furniture, everything, put stuff in storage. And it was so much work. But we got through it and now we're in a new place. But it was all from a need or a feeling in me that I needed to shift. I couldn't be stagnant. I needed to grow and change. And I followed it. And it was tough, but I'll tell you what, we are so grateful. And I totally agree with you in terms of like these things are put in place for movement and change to help people grow and flourish if you take it in that vein.
That's so powerful, that story, mm-hmm. Anne. It's like listening to your insides instead mm-hmm. of worrying about what the outside is saying or,
yeah.
you know, because you're always going to get pushback.
Oh, yeah.
Because there's all kinds of things that will not necessarily bar you, but will make you take stock and think, oh, is this the right decision?
Oh, yeah. And I'll tell you, if I may interrupt for just one second,
sorry. Go for it.
But I need to tell you that because you just brought to my mind was the biggest thing was this second time is now that I was an entrepreneur, right, with my own business, you realize that banks don't want to give you loans or approve mortgages when you are self-employed. And so that was huge. I mean, we had to bend over backward to prove that I had money coming in and that was a huge thing. And I have to say that I'm grateful and thankful that my voiceover business flourished as it did so that wasn't, I mean, it became a thing where we were worried up to the very last minute that they were not going to approve the mortgage because I had to show all sorts of records of income. And it's crazy when you work for yourself. But thank gosh, my husband, he is able to prove half of it because he worked for an employer. But for me, they were like, no, you need to prove this, this, and this. And so that became a big point. So bosses out there working for yourself, know that these things exist.
And believing in it, I think that's really important. What you just described is like, despite the no's being told,
yes,
you went ahead anyway.
And did everything I had to do, right?
Exactly.
To prove and to get through it. So absolutely.
Yeah. You know, I think there's something that's so important in this business to recognize is the amount of no's that we get.
Yeah.
And when I think about the radio,
so many.
I mean, I got so many no's and I got so many like silences because that's the other thing about this business.
Yeah.
You don't necessarily get told you don't get the part or you don't get the gig. You're just, nothing happens. So you know that it went to somebody else.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, and it's about physically and emotionally and being able to say, okay. All right, you know, and just moving on with it instead of dwelling in it.
And again, right? can I bring another marketing parallel
Go for
into
it.
This?
Love it.
So
Love
not
it.
Only auditioning and understanding that if you audition, maybe it's not the right time, right? For the person mm-hmm. that is casting that audition, maybe it's just, it wasn't the right fit for the job at that right time. But also when you're marketing and you're sending out those emails or you're making those cold calls, all the time there are no's, right? And it's just not the right time. And so keep in mind that even when you're marketing, that is absolutely a huge consideration that it's not the right time. They're not looking at that time to buy or to purchase, or they don't need a voice at that time. And the same thing applies to your marketing. So I know so many people, they get so defeated about their marketing and like, why isn't it working? And how can I get the next gig? And it's one of those, it's a huge timing issue. And I know when I talk to my Boss Blast clients that is a thing. You know, we get so many emails in our inbox every day. And like, I subscribe to Old Navy, right? So Old Navy 3, 4, or 5 times a week is sending me their latest sale. But I don't click on that email until I need something. And so mm-hmm. the same thing goes for if you're trying to market your voiceover business. And that could be a whole nother episode, Pilar, with that.
I think it is. I think it is because I have a story, which I'm not going to include,
yep.
but I have a great story about that. And that's really important. Yeah.
So I love, love, love all the parallels that we are making through your story. So thank you, Pilar, for providing that story. So now I'm going to assume that next move, is that coming back to New York?
No.
Oh,
it's
or
going to
LA.
Angeles. Yes.
So we are going to be hitting the next episode with when you now, I guess, leave Miami and make your trek towards LA. So, bosses, I can't wait for this next episode. Pilar, thank you so much again for this inspiring, motivating story. I'm just so glad that we're doing this.
I get such a kick out of talking with you, Anne. I learn so much with you. So thank you.
Well, I love drawing the parallels. So
I love it. I love it. You're good at it.
So I'd like to give a great big shout out to our sponsor, IPDTL. You two can connect just like Pilar and I are connecting like bosses. Find out more at IPDTL.com. You guys have an amazing week and can't wait to see you next week. See ya. Bye.
Bye.
Join us next week for another edition of VO Boss with your host, Anne Ganguza. And take your business to the next level. Sign up for our mailing list at voboss.com and receive exclusive content, industry revolutionizing tips and strategies, and new ways to rock your business like a boss. Redistribution with permission, coast-to-coast connectivity via IPDTL.